You're watching ESPN's Rivalry Week, presented by Wendy's.
From Stegman Coliseum in Athens, Georgia, this is the SEC on ESPN. And in a series that dates to 1924, the Florida Gators and Georgia Bulldogs meet on the hardwood tonight in Athens. Welcome, everybody. Tom Hart alongside Kara Lawson. What a weekend it was for these Florida Gators. Saturday against Kentucky, a game the Gators never trailed. They shot 67% in the second half. They held a ranked Kentucky team to its largest defeat in the quarter century. And the Florida Gators ran their SEC record to 8-2, a team that's won four in a row. They are in a three-team race, it seems, for an SEC title. And Kara, tonight they have to deal with perhaps the best player in the conference. That's Yonte Maton for Georgia.
He's got a tremendous case for SEC Player of the Year. You put him on the low block, and he has the ability to score over or around anyone in this league. It is a huge challenge for Florida on the interior tonight to deal with Mr. Maton.
Lenardi's latest, Florida currently a three seed. Georgia was on the bubble a couple of weeks ago. The Bulldogs looking for a signature win tonight. Florida controls the tip, the Gators in the road blues, Georgia in the home white. Immediately inside, then back outside. Here's Devin Robinson and Casey Hill. A balanced Florida attack. They've been led by eight different scorers over the course of an 18-win season thus far. Kayvon Allen challenged, and he threw it away. An early Florida turnover for a team that's won four in a row and has averaged 91 points a game during their four-game win streak. Turtle Jackson will run the point for Florida. That means J.J. Frazier will be off the ball to start, and he's guarded by Casey Hill in the corner. They're looking for Maton and nothing there. Here's the lefty, Frazier. Juwan Parker lost it, regathered, forces it up short. Gators go inside, nothing there. Derek Alvede with the rebound. Alvede gets doubled and kicks it out to Jackson. Little floater, not there, and it's brought down by Devin Robinson. Trailing three, Justin Leon. And a whistle underneath. And a foul will go against the Gators. John Egbunu's first. Mark Fox has tied the school record of four 20-plus win seasons. Bulldogs sitting just three games above 500 right now and two games under in SEC play. They played a tough schedule. They just haven't had that signature win yet. They have been a heartbroken team throughout the course of conference play. Turtle Jackson short, rebounded by Juwan Parker.
Watch the defender for Obede. I mean, playing a ton of center field. It was Egbunu, and now it's Hayes. Really is 4-on-5 at times for Georgia on the offensive end.
Corner three off the kick from Frazier. Next score. Our first score comes from Turtle Jackson.
That's a great sign. Georgia relies so heavily on J.J. Frazier and Yonte Maton to score the basketball. Anytime some of their role players can get going, what a block for Obede.
And a beautiful feed inside to Yonte Maton.
Yeah, even with that depressed defense, Obede finds a way to get that high-low action. They will look for that. Either guy, high-low passing, trying to take advantage of their strength in the paint.
Hill behind the screen. It was halfway home and came back out, and then a step on the end line from Florida's Justin Leon. Big time defensive effort.
Obede just with the great timing, and you better be ready to defend in the paint and high low. And just a nice pass there, leading Maton away from the other two Florida defenders in the easy bucket. That might be one of the easier buckets Yonte Maton gets all night.
Frazier off the curl, not there, follow jam neither, and a foul well after the rebound will go against Juwan Parker. It's his first.
And he touched on it at the top, Tom, how important this game is for Georgia. They have had their heart broken. a few times this season, specifically on the road. They have a game, this game left against Florida. They have a game left against Kentucky. Those opportunities are getting smaller and smaller for Georgia to get some great wins.
Mark Fox's team has lost 4 out of their last 5. The latest coming Saturday at South Carolina, a game that featured 8 ties and 18 lead changes. They have yet to find a win against top 25, including an overtime win at Rupp Arena a week ago. Tried to split the defenders. Here's Leon cutting down the lane.
Yeah, that's really nice. I mean, 2 are going to Kayvon Allen off those ball screens. Hard hedge. If you can reverse it and get some timely cuts on the weak side, you get that. A nice cut and a nice finish.
Ogbede too strong. Leon again for 3. Why not? 41% from deep. That's his first make. He's not afraid of that trailing shot.
Yeah, that trail 3 is so difficult to defend sometimes in transition defense because you have to protect the paint first and then come out.
Florida has been a fantastic transition team all season, both offensively and defensively. Kayvon Allen trying to push it, knocked away by Parker. Quick start to this one. Florida on a 5-0 run after falling behind by 5 to evenly matched teams tonight in Athens.
ESPN's exclusive presentation of college basketball is presented by CenturyLink, your link to what's next. And in part by Allstate. It's good to be in good hands.
Second meeting of the season between these two teams in a logjam in the thick of the SEC standings. 9 teams all within 2 games right in the middle, but the focus should be on the top. Welcome back, everybody. Tom Arnold alongside Kara Lawson. The perception of this league is one thing. Perception of the top, you think, is something that people should take note of.
Yeah, I mean, you look at Kentucky, and we know what they have. They have a ton of talent, a ton of freshmen and players that are going to go to the NBA. You know, South Carolina and Florida, to me, are right with Kentucky in terms of their ability to play at a high level, at an elite level, but also to go deep in the NCAA tournament. I think sometimes people look at South Carolina and Florida and say, oh, they're a nice team. They might be able to get 1 win or 2 wins. I think these teams have the ability to go to the second weekend, and if things break right for them, they could be Final Four teams as well, especially when you look at the way Florida is playing on both ends of the floor right now and their depth. If they get quality point guard play from Casey Hill and Chris Chioza, this is a team that can go far.
And Chris Chioza comes off the bench to nail a 3. I wonder if maybe some of that lack of respect within this league, there's Mayton, is based on the fact that those two teams you just talked about, primarily defensive teams. Florida and South Carolina, 2 of the best defensive teams in all of college basketball. And maybe that's not as sexy to some from a national perspective. And there's Devin Robinson converting.
Well, the other thing I think that plays into it, Tom, is that you have 2 rosters that are devoid of those one-and-done type players that really catch our attention, whether it's a UCLA with Lonzo Ball and TJ Leaf or a Kentucky. You have these teams across the country, but when you look at how competent they are in all areas and how balanced South Carolina and Florida are, they're teams that are going to be contending to get to the Sweet 16 and to get to the Final Four in the NCAA tournament, I believe, this year.
Devin Robinson makes it a 3-point play, and we see Canyon Berry, one of the best 6th men in college basketball, checking in. He had 27 last time these teams met, including 5 threes. Good feed to Mayton. And it's rejected by Javarius Hayes.
Yonte Mayton is devastating. 1-on-1 on the paint. There's a great job by Hayes there to help out his buddy. You've got to be able to bring extra defenders, whether it's early, whether it's on the catch, whether it's after the catch, to try and disrupt the rhythm of Yonte Mayton in the paint.
Frazier's able to get in, and that one's rejected. Back-to-back blocks by Kevarius Hayes. That will key a Florida breakout.
Nice pass.
And a beautiful feed converted by Hayes. Florida scored 11 of the last 13. Nice look. Mike Edwards got it. He's hit six of his last seven shots for the reserve forward from Westland, Michigan. Chioza. I can just kind of see it in your eyes. You're a big Chris Chioza fan.
Yeah, I am. He's been one of my favorite players in this league for a long time just because of his court stance. Gosh, I thought that could have been a foul with Kenyon Berry getting bumped off his rhythm there a little bit.
Instead, it's a miss and an opportunity for Georgia. They're looking for Edwards again. Great post defense by Florida, specifically Hayes. But Egbuda is a great post defender as well. 13 seconds left on the shot clock. But Chris Chioza is your reigning SEC Player of the Week, coming off of a triple-double against Missouri two games ago. That was the first triple-double off the bench in 9 years.
You know, think about this Florida team and the number of guards that they have. I mean, certainly Kayvon Allen, their leading scorer. Casey Hill has played very, very well this season. Chioza and Kenyon Berry come off the bench. So the depth that this team has on the perimeter is a strength.
Shot clock winding down. Frazier has to heave. And Egbunu brings it down. Chioza, they go under the screen, but he can't make him pay. Nice feed. Stone has his shot blocked. And Edwards fouled by Berry in the open floor. You know, we were just talking today about J.J. Frazier's shooting percentage being sub 40%. Yep. And you brought up a great point. Sometimes, as the senior leader and a point guard, you get stuck with end-of-the-shot-clock shots that are very low percentage, and that can affect your overall shooting percentage.
Well, there's no question. Over the course of the season, a guy like J.J. Frazier that's depending on so heavily end-of-shot-clock, end-of-half situations, sometimes you get stuck with the basketball because someone passes up a shot.
Berry on the steal, and he converts.
And all of a sudden, you're taking 1 to 2 shots a game that are just low percentage shots because you're trying to get it up on the rim to help your team. Well, you extrapolate that out over the course of a season, I mean, that can take your shooting percentage down 5 to 7%.
Obede fighting for it. J.J. Frazier is shooting 12% when the shot clock is at 4 seconds or less. And both of these teams are not great jump shooting teams, so they're both low percentage plays when the shot clock gets that low. Georgia turns it over, right back to Florida, leading by 6.
I mean, all guards have to deal with that. It's not just J.J. Frazier. You sometimes get stuck with the basketball in your hands, and it's not going to be a quality look, and it's part of it. But I think sometimes we forget as a whole when we're looking at statistics that can depress a guard's shooting percentage, you know, by a certain amount over the course of a season.
Allen, a little leaner. As long as it doesn't depress the player, that's fine.
I don't know if J.J. Frazier will get depressed about shooting a rock.
He's in lead campus as one of the most influential players in the history of this program in terms of steals, assists, and points. Top 10 throughout for a 1,000-point score. Chioza with a burst all the way in and off the window. That's 5 off the bench for Chris Chioza. Florida's largest lead of the game, and Mark Fox has to use a timeout.
Florida comes in on this game on a 4-game winning streak. They are excellent in transition. Chris Chioza with the nice dime. Hayes is able to finish. And then how about Kenyon Berry? Defense to offense. The Gators off and running, up by double digits.
I'm Adam Van Verk alongside Seth Greenberg with his studio update. Coach, Alabama and South Carolina, this is Avery Johnson Jr. here.
Avery Johnson Jr. knocking down the jumper, but obviously the defense of Alabama has been special in this basketball game.
Up 30-15 right now, and the Terps right now trailing Penn State by 9. That one is in the second. Back to Tom and Kara.
All right, Adnan, thanks. Here in Athens, it's a 19-9 lead. You know, Kenyon Berry's free throw shooting has been well chronicled throughout this season. Our guy Seth, and Seth don't go anywhere. We're going to talk to you in a moment. He tried to get in on it on a recent trip to Gainesville last Thursday, he even put up an air ball. Here's Karolos and my partner, first attempt at the granny, nailed it. Now, of course, she also had a great rebounder this afternoon, so I want all the credit I can get. But Seth didn't have so much luck. At least now I understand he at least has his earpiece in, right, Seth?
I have my earpiece in. Kara, how many points did you score in your career at Tennessee?
Seth, do you at least have your earpiece in today? Because it seems to be a trend with you these days.
I have my earpiece in. I wonder how many points Kara scored in her career. Because she scored a lot more points than I did. I can guarantee you that.
Let me tell you how good Kara Lawson was today. We're on the East Coast Saturday at Syracuse. Then she goes West Coast for a women's game last night. She shows up today basically running on fumes, gets out there ice cold, and she shoots like 90% from the floor just messing around today.
Let me tell you, Kara is no marshmallow. I mean, she's the toughest analyst in all of ESPN basketball. I'm sitting here to Jay Will. If he had to go cross country twice, he'd be taking a nap right now.
Jay Will, a little tissue paper next to you, Seth, huh? Hey, Seth, you know, I know you spent some time last week in Gainesville and got a chance to see this Florida team up close and personal. What do you feel like are the strengths of this group as they head to a March run?
This is an elite defensive team. They do a terrific job of pressuring the ball. They don't get split. They protect the front of the rim. And then offensively, I think they're really connected. They share the basketball. They come at you at a warp speed, and they get downhill. I was really impressed with them.
And this Florida team now going on another mini run right here. Obede brings it down. Seth, we started this broadcast talking about the perception of the SEC, specifically the perception of the top teams. Kara is of the mind that teams like South Carolina and Florida specifically don't get enough national respect. Could that be because of their style of play, because they're such defensive-minded teams?
Yet, if you look like a team at Auburn, Auburn has three wins against the Big 12. They've struggled within conference, but they've been very successful out of conference. The key to the SEC, more out-of-conference wins, because just like any other league, once you get in conference, whether it's the ACC, the Big 12, the SEC, you start beating each other up because you're so familiar with your opponent.
Seth, thanks for hanging around, and thanks for keeping your earpiece in. We know that's been a challenge for you.
It's a little tough keeping your earpiece in. There's no doubt about it. But, you know, sometimes I'm better without the earpiece.
I understand. Devin Robinson with the three. We'll hear from Adnan and Seth later on. Obviously, Florida has opened up a 12-point lead. So extrapolating that and applying it to Georgia now, if Mark Fox wants to get this Georgia team to the NCAA tournament, that makes tonight a must-win because of the opportunities down the road. They still have Kentucky. They still have Auburn. They still go to Arkansas, but they just haven't come away with that big win, and more often than not, Kara, it's been because of a heartbreaking finish.
Yeah, it's not about being close at this point if you're Georgia. It's about getting some of those wins, and the way Florida is playing, shooting the basketball, wow, Leon Robinson, those guys just knocking down threes.
They made 10 of their last 14 shots now. Mayton got fouled, and Chioza may have taken a shot to the mouth off of a Mayton elbow. They're certainly going to take a look at that. And they likely will, I should say. Chris Chioza whips it for the foul. You mentioned the Florida offense. The last four games are averaging 91 points a game. 93, pardon me. They're winning the games by 32 points. I mean, they've put up video game numbers over the last four. At LSU, at Oklahoma, Missouri, and Kentucky, they handed the Sooners their worst home loss in 95 years. Officials have gone to the monitor. Doug Sermon's their lead official tonight alongside Joe Lindsay and Roger Ayers. And they want to see if Mayton should be charged with a flagrant on the connection with Chioza here. It was definite connection, but it looked like the Kalman foul on Chioza, nothing doing with Mayton. That's just a basketball play right there.
That's just sticking your chin if you're Chioza in where it's not supposed to be.
Chioza gets a breather. 5 points off the bench after a triple-double 2 games ago against Mizzou, and another steal by Florida. Hayes. And he gets fouled leaning in, and that will be on Yante Maton. First on the Georgia star.
We've seen this a couple times in the early going for Georgia, and that's just not a good pass across the boards. And Hayes, very opportunistic there, shooting the gap and getting the steal. You're Georgia. You can't afford to give Florida too many opportunities running downhill with numbers. I mean, you look at the athletes on this Florida team. They are at their best when they get out and transition and run.
Javarius Hayes only had 2 points in the last matchup with Georgia. That was an overtime Florida win. Gators trailed for 35 minutes of that game down in Gainesville. Came back to win. Maton, baseline. Ooh. What a move to reverse it and draw the foul. And Yante Maton's going to the free throw line. A lot of different ways to measure Yante Maton's effectiveness. Our friends at Synergy Sports tell us that he is in the 98th percentile when it comes to post-ups. He shoots 62% from the floor when he posts up, and he gets to the free throw line 29% of the time. That's an amazing number.
You know, he's to the point now in the season where he's seen just about every coverage that he's going to see. And so getting double teamed and seeing different styles of defenses, the way you get better at reading them is repetition, just like being a shooter. And so he's starting to see the same things over and over and over, the different coverages, and you see how quickly he's able to transition and attack, even with multiple defenders.
Hill behind the screen, brought down by Kessler. Georgia down 2 touchdowns, looking for a spark. Into Maton, he hesitated a moment. That allowed Florida to converge on him. He still got a bucket.
Three players.
Taken away by Poggiata in Georgia. The deficit's a dozen. Frazier, got it! Timeout, Florida.
The Bulldogs are not going to go quietly. And on the backs of their two best players, Yante Maton and J.J. Frazier, they're going to have something to say about this deficit.
Coming up on the Land Rover Halftime Report alongside Jay Williams and Coach Seth Greenberg, I'm Adam Amber. A couple of ranked teams right now struggling. Maryland and South Carolina will also look ahead to UNC Duke Thursday. It can be a ton of fun.
1,950 is how many points Kara Lawson scored in 4 years. I scored 2,092 in 3, and I still get no love from Seth Greenberg.
Yeah.
Still get no respect.
Wait a second.
Them.
They weren't talking to
no respect from
Kara
at all.
On your opinion. I got 400.
This is
wins.
My life.
She wanted expert
Kara,
analysis.
This is my life, Kara.
She didn't need a score.
Every day.
She wanted expert analysis. You're not going to pass the ball anyway.
Comedy Hour with Jay and Seth continues throughout the night on ESPN2.
Jay and I go way back. I got love for everybody in that studio. Jay and I were the same year coming out of high school, actually.
Poggiata for 3. Georgia's run continues. They've made it a 2-possession game. Leon, nope. And Kessler gets bumped from behind by Devin Robinson. 10-0 Georgia run to make this thing interesting, no matter what your sweater looks like.
This turned really quick, didn't it?
Yes.
Yante Maton gets that layup. Frazier comes down with the transition three, and all of a sudden, this thing is close.
Georgia's hit its last 3, including a pair of triples. Mismatch. Nope, that's a good matchup with Maton, but he still wants it. Working on Leon at 6'8". Whoa. And Yante Maton picks up his second at the 6'47 mark. He fouled out in the first matchup.
I don't know about that.
with just under four to go. Georgia up five in the game, but they saw it slip away in Gainesville.
Mark Fox taking Maiden out with just the one foul. Trying to guard with the second foul. Can't afford to have him pick up a third foul here in the last 6.5 minutes. Georgia in a 2-3 zone right now, trying to protect that paint.
The Florida drought continues. They haven't scored since the 8:37 mark. That was a Hayes free throw. So the question is, where does Georgia look on the offensive end?
This guy right here with the ball.
Frazier to his left.
Yeah, that's really nice.
He scores 43% of the time he comes off the screen. That's one of the highest numbers in basketball.
Well, he did a great job against that ice coverage, just getting in that shooting pocket right there.
Barry, maybe a push-off. It still won't go. Frazier's got the board. Bodies flying. Frazier with a burst off the glass. J.J. Frazier in Georgia. They've made it a one-point game. Jackson coming out of his shell.
How about this energy on both ends for the Georgia Bulldogs? And Turtle sending that shot back. And, you know, the energy, the aggressiveness with which they're playing. And the other thing they're doing is they're able to limit Florida to one shot. And that's enabling them to get out and run and play with some pace on the offensive end.
Florida's missed its last 7 field goal attempts. They go under again. Chioza, no. Obede is there. Good hands.
Yep.
And now Chioza will go full speed. Allen. Another miss for the Gators. They've missed their last 9. Frazier for 3. Barry wanted a grab. Looked like they had a hold of his forearm before the shot, but he didn't get the whistle. It's a 15-0 Georgia run, thanks to 10 straight Florida misses. Deep entry, but Chioza's got another steal. Wow. They still don't have a make, but Jackson charged with a foul. J.J. Frazier, one of the best in the business.
He's got going a little bit. I mean, that burst and his ability to knock down tough shots here. Great job reading the ball screen coverage and just a rise and fire. And how about this? I mean, he just turns on the turbo jets.
ESPN's exclusive presentation of college basketball is brought to you by Wendy's, proud sponsor of the 2017 John R. Wooden Player of the Year, and Hilton. Stop clicking around. Book direct at Hilton.com.
Ah, yeah. Doubleheader night. East Coast, West Coast. But which is the best coast? In the East, one of sports' greatest rivalries. But then there's the edge of your seat West Coast. You know what? Don't worry. You don't have to choose. We're going coast to coast, baby.
Because we gonna blow your mind.
Let's take a look at tonight's Wendy's Wooden Watch. Some guys playing in some big games this week, including that Carolina-Duke game on Thursday. Luke Kennard scoring nearly 20 points a game for Duke.
I can't wait for that doubleheader. You look at how Oregon throttled Arizona. I mean, Arizona is coming in, playing exceptionally well, getting the services of Alonzo Trier back, and Oregon just handed it to them. Now they have to go up against UCLA and that high-powered offense.
What about Florida's offense? They've gone greater than 5 minutes without a point. Oh, Chioza will end it, making the back end. And Casey Hill returns, replacing Chioza.
So this is a challenge for Georgia on the offensive end. Deontay Maton on the bench with two fouls. J.J. Frazier getting a quick blow. He's walking to the scorer's table right now. I'm sorry, Deontay Maton is in the game for Georgia.
During what was a 15-0 run, Frazier had seven and Maton had four. That's not terrible for Georgia. 14 seconds on the shot clock, and they get Frazier back in after a quick breather. Awkward location for the inbounds. Single digits on the shot clock. Maton will throw it up. Oh, my goodness. We are tied at 31 on a circus shot by Deontay Maton. And Giada gets whistled for the foul.
At the end of the shot clock, and he was out of options. And Deontay Maton just had that size advantage over Casey Hill that enabled him to get a clean look at the basket.
So you're laughing at me for being a stats geek recently. Uh-huh. I've kind of fallen in love with the under four on the shot clock number. Deontay Maton is in the 98th percentile with under 4 seconds on the shot clock. He scores 73% of the time.
So what you're telling me is under 4 seconds, more Deontay Maton, less J.J. Frazier?
Yes, okay. Find number one. Find him at any time in the shot clock, really. I mean, perhaps the SEC Player of the Year, and he's got some pretty good company, including Sindarius Thornwell, be mentioned for that, Malik Monk, who leads the league in scoring.
Yeah, I think those are the three front runners, and certainly Malik Monk and Sindarius Thornwell's teams are enjoying a little bit more success in the win-loss column, but Deontay Maton has been terrific, and he might be the toughest player to defend in the SEC one-on-one.
Matthew Griffin is the athletic trainer for Georgia. He's taking a look at a bloody lip for Deontay Maton. Our next NBA Wednesday doubleheader starts at Madison Square Garden as the Clippers continuing their road trip against the Knicks at 7 Eastern. Then after that one, it's the Bulls taking on KD, Steph, and the Warriors at Oracle. Both games are on ESPN, also streaming live on the ESPN app and watch ESPN. They're going to walk Deontay Maton all the way back to the Georgia locker room to try and stop the bleeding, or at least back in the hallway to have some privacy. Frazier splits the defense, finds Harris. Well, lost it and saved right over Foton by Justin Leon. And we got a foul on the floor on this end. J.J. Frazier picks up his first. Deontay Maton, the other leading scorer for Georgia, has two.
Looks like Kayvon Allen might have tweaked his back a little bit. You see him grimacing in pain at the free throw line right now, putting his two hands towards his back.
Sophomore from Little Rock, Arkansas. And he's able to get it to roll home. 86% free throw shooter, one of the best in school history throughout his career.
I know you've dealt with a bad back. I can't imagine trying to play with it.
Yeah, I think it's a good move by Mike White just to get him out and get him looked at, because that thing can tighten up on you. You know, you tweak it a little bit, and then it's a little bit worse. So going into halftime, keeping that thing warm and seeing, you know, Kayvon Allen is Florida's leading scorer, and he's a guy that can get hot in a hurry, just like we've seen J.J. Frazier for Georgia.
Pop Giotto with the drive. Fire for the junior. Florida has missed its last 10 after getting off to a hot start.
Yeah, there we go for Casey Hill. I mean, he was so good at hitting those mid-range shots in their upset win against Kentucky. Defenders go under the screen on him time and time again, so he has to be able to have that ability to step up and make those long twos.
Power dribble from Ogbeide. What did they call that today? The Nemi dribble after Nemi Jurišić?
Yeah.
Hill skips in, got hammered, nothing doing. And it will stay this way. Hill had a blowout, so he'll get laced up again as Leon returns. And Keith Stone, who's been battling an illness with limited time here in the first half, missed the last two games. Back to the corner. Good ball fake. Chioza will let it fly. Boy, all eyes on Frazier in the transition defense by Florida. And it's one and done for Georgia. Robinson. And a push off inside on Leon. His second. Barry back on the floor.
Thank you, down there for me. Good call there, man.
Thank you, pal.
Frazier picked up his dribble. Ogbeide looking. 10-second difference between the game clock and shot clock. And Georgia stale. Harris got a half step. Chioza rips it away. His third steal of the half. And Florida will have an opportunity to close the half. Robinson, short corner. Barry follows, and that's followed the other way by Ogbeide. A back and forth affair. Florida went on a lead 30-14 before Georgia ends the half on a 19-5 run. J.J. Frazier, Yante Maton, Keaton. Halftime here in Athens. We'll be back with our Land Rover halftime report right after these messages.
You're watching ESPN's Rivalry Week, presented by Wendy's.
Well, it's a series that dates to 1924 in the second meeting of the season. Florida and Georgia here. This is the SEC on ESPN. We welcome you back courtside. A 35-33 lead for the 17th-ranked Gators. Tom Hart alongside Kara Lawson. Florida got off to a red-hot start. Looks like the team that has won four in a row with great defense leading to fantastic offense before Georgia made things really interesting.
Florida got after Georgia on the defensive end. They were able to disrupt their rhythm, get in the passing lane, shoot the gap. And what does that allow Florida to do? It allows them to do this. That's get off and running, utilize their athleticism. Brilliant find here by Cheese, Chris Chioza, who's coming off a triple-double last week against Missouri, and then Kenyon Berry in the passing lanes as well. Georgia was out of sorts, and they needed something to change, and change very quickly, Tom Hart.
All right, let's go. It's Turpin. We got quick change performing and a quick change by the Dogs.
One of the best halftime acts out there. And quick change Georgia did. And in the second part of that first half, Yonte Maton and J.J. Frazier got going. Those are the two guys that needed to put this team on their backs on the offensive end. They combined for 18 points. And as a result of the quick change, we've got a two-point ball game here to start the second half.
Now we just need something to happen and Red Panda to come in the building. Then we'll really be cooking with fire.
Oh, man, if Red Panda comes in the building.
Canyon Berry starts the second half for Florida. He is one of the best six men in the country, but almost goes down on a forearm to his back. Jackson fires a three. And there's Berry on the glass. Yonte Maton left the game after taking a shot to the lip. A couple minutes left in the first half. We understand he's been stitched up. Little bandage there on the upper lip, and he's back on the floor. Here's Berry. Shot clock is at six. Great body control, but the finish isn't there. And Albede has the board. His ninth rebound tonight.
Well, interesting that Kayvon Allen is not starting the second half for Florida. Remember, towards the end of that first half, it looked like he tweaked his back a little bit. You wonder if that is the reason why he's not starting here. The leading scorer for the Florida Gators sitting on the bench.
Allen hasn't returned since he made that second free throw and was lifted from the game. He's at the very end of the Florida bench. He left at the 2:09 mark. Shot clock at 10 already. Frazier guarded by Hill. Frazier for three, short. And now Chioza. Juwan Parker gets whistled. It was an inadvertent shot to the face on a Yonte Maton ball fake that got him to pop to that upper lip. Casey Hill. And then a shove on the rebound, 24 feet away from the hoop, will bring Hill his first personal.
Well, the other change coming out of the gates here for Mike White in the second half, Devin Robinson on the bench to start as well. So this makes Florida a little bit smaller with Canyon Berry at that small forward position. So a little bit more vulnerable on the glass.
And it has Hill and Chioza on the floor together for the first time tonight. Parker, nice shake, forgot the basketball. And then a foul on Juwan Parker, and he immediately picks up his third. So he'll have to take a seat.
Yeah. Knocks Leon off balance. And that's just a bad play to put yourself in that position. And if you're Juwan Parker, not even really getting an opportunity to get your feet wet in this game. Nice floater there by Casey Hill.
Maton, power move, and a power rejection. Coming out of nowhere to help was Kevarius Hayes.
We saw Hayes do this in the first half as well. Weak side, slamming back down and helping out his teammate who's one-on-one with Yonte Maton. Man, what great help side defense. How quickly he got there from the free throw line all the way to the basket.
That's his third block. Here's Turtle Jackson down the lane. And there to greet him was Hayes again. Hill gets tied up and Frazier stepped on the end line. Oh, Mike White. Chris Chioza. And now Frazier on the other end. out to Mayton. First triple for Yante Mayton.
And Mayton shoots 49% from three. Jeez, Mark Fox was all the way out on the floor trying to get that timeout.
Both coaches fired up here in this second half. After a back-and-forth affair in the first half, Florida leads by three. 3 minutes into the second half in Athens.
ESPN's exclusive presentation of college basketball is brought to you by Wendy's, proud sponsor of the 2017 John R. Wooden Player of the Year.
You're watching ESPN Super Tuesday presented by CenturyLink. Thursday, big-time rivalry week doubleheader on ESPN. It gets started with a battle for Tobacco Road at 8 o'clock, the 2017 version. Number 8, North Carolina, and number 18, Duke. And after we're done at Cameron Indoor, Sun Chow West, the Pauley Pavilion for number 5, Oregon, and 10th-ranked UCLA. Both Sonic blockbusters are streaming live on the ESPN app and watch ESPN. Advantage inside for Florida. And the bucket goes for Kevarius Hayes.
He's given them some good minutes off the bench, hasn't he? I mean, been a force on the defensive end of the floor. Doing a nice job of being active offensively, Hayes is.
Kessler gets tied up inside. Shot clock at 12. Jackson going into Hayes, who comes away with a takeaway. J.J. Frazier never touched the ball that possession for Georgia. He was hounded by Chioza, then a bump inside from Houston Kessler.
Well, that will only count as one block for Hayes on the defensive end of the floor, but when Houston Kessler went to drive, he saw Hayes there and he stopped. He jump stopped, he turned around, he said, you know what, I'm going to think better of this. Yeah, Hayes is starting to get in the head a little bit of some of these Georgia players because he's a backstop. And he can elevate and not foul just by keeping that principle of verticality.
Bob Giada gets whistled for the foul. Here's Frazier after the knockaway. Mayton, and we'll get a foul on Hayes, his first. That was a beautiful feed right where Mayton wanted it.
Yeah, you know, Georgia does a pretty good job in terms of post-entry, and post-entry can take away the good positioning if it's a poor pass. If it's a good pass, you can lead your teammate, you can lead your post player into a finish, into an easier finish. So the art of post-passing and post-entry can go a long way to making your post players more efficient. Away from the defender and allowing you to turn into your shot. You know, kind of like a quarterback throwing a receiver open, putting it on the route, putting it on the way in stride, and allowing them to, what do you guys call that, yak?
Yeah.
Yards after catch?
Sure.
Yeah.
But, you know, here in the greater Atlanta area, if you allow me to spread it out a little bit,
yeah.
We're not thinking about football season anymore.
Okay, my bad. I didn't mean to bring it up. It's too soon?
Too soon.
I got you.
Mayton goes 2-2 from the line. Georgia's going to mix it up defensively here. First time we've seen the 1-2-2. Florida's a great transition team. What's the purpose of that for Mark Fox against these Gators?
Delay and disrupt. Just take some time off the shot clock, force them to get into their continuity a little bit later than normal.
Chioza is so strong. A little jump stop got him some room. And a foul on Leon. That's his third personal foul. Those are piling up.
You know, Chris Chioza has played very well in the last week, averaging double-digit rebounds, double-digit assists, utilizing the strength.
It's Tonight at 11 Eastern on ESPN, it's Sports Center Night with John and John. Bucci, Grosh, and Anderson. They'll have highlights from the Patriots Victory Parade. Do I have to read that one? The Patriots Victory Parade? The NBA, NHL, college basketball, and everything else. Sports Center Night also streaming live on the app and watch ESPN. As we're going to break, we had double technical fouls. Look at the left side of your screen on the left wing, Pop Giotta and Devin Robinson. Assess technicals each for taunting. So for Devin Robinson, his second personal foul, and for Giotta, his third. You know, that might seem, Kara, really picky, but we've seen a high intensity level in this game. And you would assume that Roger Ayers and this crew just trying to make sure that it doesn't get too wild and too chippy. And now a turnover by Georgia on the over and back.
Yeah, setting the tone, a little extracurricular going on after the whistle. Robinson hits the ball out of his hand. Of course, we're not privy to what was said verbally by either guy, but Roger Ayers, one of the great veteran officials, and not only in the SEC, but in the country.
Stone, an air ball. Mayton turns it over, stolen by Casey Hill. And a reaching foul on Harris.
You know, we talked about, and you showed a highlight about how post-entry can make an easier shot for you. That was an example of a post-entry making it harder for Yonte Mayton. It took him out of his post-up where he had to turn and face up, then made a poor pass cross-court.
Jordan Harris charged with the foul. Well, that's what Florida does one way or another. They turn you over. Plus four turnover margin leads the SEC. They get more than a quarter of their points off of turnovers. And here's Canyon Berry to the free throw line. We saw Kara practicing the underhand free throw pregame. She made her first. Credit to the rebounder. He hasn't missed in a month from the free throw line. He's now third in the SEC at 89%. Michael Frazier had the last great run. He had 33 in a row a couple seasons ago. And Canyon Berry ties that run. Yeah, Florida fans know all about it. Mayton guarded by Chioza. Still gets a fingertip on it. Steal number four for Chris Chioza. Berry left wide open. Boom. That is typical Florida.
All that started from Chris Chioza getting the switch, fronting Yonte Mayton, and making a heck of a play on the defensive end. And Georgia makes the right decision here to have Yonte Mayton go to the block to try and exploit this matchup. It was just a poor post-entry pass here, allowing Chioza to get the steal. And then they're off and running. Canyon Berry knocking it down.
Seven nothing Florida run to get back in front by double figures, and J.J. Frazier will end that run with a little leaner. Offensive board. Brought down by Keith Stone. Nicely done by Hill. Should Florida hold on to what is a 10-point lead, they could find themselves in a three-way tie for first in the league tonight. Alabama has a 10-point lead late in the game at South Carolina. That would be the Gamecocks' second conference loss of the year. Parker, challenge two. And Chioza lost it. That dude plays hard, doesn't he?
Oh, love it. Love the way he's played tonight. Deflections, picking up steals.
Kayvon Allen has returned for Florida. We haven't seen him since the two-minute mark of the first half. Seemed like he was bothered by a lower back issue. Frazier takes some tough shots sometimes.
Same play with Casey Hill, just an open side two-man game, and utilizing his strength and quickness.
Hill whistled for the offensive foul. Twenty-five of Georgia's 40 have come from their stars, Mayton and Frazier, two of the top six scorers in the SEC.
Got the switch again.
Good feed. Oh, and another fantastic block from Florida. That time it comes from Igbunu. They go right back to number one, and he's rejected again. Tough times inside for Yante Mayton. Berry, three. Lift, but instead to get Edwards for the trip.
How good has Florida's help defense been, particularly against Yante Mayton when he's making move towards the basket? That's Igbunu coming over the help. And you've got Stone, the freshman, coming over as well. I mean, that's what you have to do. You have to load up on Yante Mayton and J.J. Frazier. Make other guys beat you. Make them score through and around multiple defenders. Florida's done a pretty good job of that in the half court tonight.
They've got Crump guarding Hill. And Crump able to get his hands on that one. Frazier, beautiful look. And Edwards a jam. Mike White wants a timeout. Probably wants the offense to start over there with Hill, guarded by Crump. It was a key. Mark Fox put Crump on Hill instead of Frazier.
They've been going to the well with that play the last three or four times down. If you continue to go under the screen, Igbunu just sets it lower and lower and lower. And Casey Hill, a capable jump shooter from that distance.
Frazier fouled. And he'll go to the free throw line. He will be there when we return. We've got 11 minutes and 9 seconds left in the 213th meeting between Florida and Georgia.
Ah, yeah. Doubleheader night. East Coast, West Coast. But which is the best coast? In the East, one of sports' greatest rivalries. But then there's the edge of your seat, West Coast. You know what? Don't worry. You don't have to choose. We're going coast to coast, baby.
Cause we gonna blow your mind.
This Thursday, Carolina Duke followed by Oregon, UCLA. What a night for college basketball. And how about this comp? Joe Lunardi has both UCLA and Florida as three seeds. If we didn't see the names on the front of the jerseys, which one are you taking, or does that influence anybody?
Well, I'm taking Florida because they're the more balanced team. I mean, you look at UCLA and their defensive efficiency, 150th in the country.
Not good, as they
That's
say.
That's not good.
They were talking with Seth about it early in the first half. Kentucky in this league is known as an offensive team, right? One of the top scoring teams in all of college basketball, despite some recent struggles. South Carolina and Florida make their money on defense. Florida, a better offensive team than South Carolina. We're seeing that over the last four games, certainly seeing that tonight in Columbia as the Gamecocks are struggling to find the basket.
Yeah, I would hope South Carolina's the team that makes their money on their defense, because goodness gracious, what'd they shoot, 10% in that first half against Alabama? Wow.
Made three baskets in the first half. Justin Leon is into double figures.
You know, but in all seriousness about South Carolina, we had a chance to see them up close and personal against Kentucky. Sands, P.J. Dozier, how physical Frank Martin's team is on the defensive end. They make everything difficult for you.
Florida's making really difficult on Yonte Maton in the second half, collapsing around Georgia's big man. And now Leon transition, barely draws the front of the rim. Georgia's turned it over six times this half. Beautiful dunk. Maton still challenged. And finally an and one. That's the fourth on Leon.
Yonte Maton has earned every point that he's gotten tonight. I mean, Hayes comes out of nowhere again and just disturbs him on that first shot attempt, but he sticks with it. 17 points for Yonte Maton here.
So Leon will have to take a seat for a while.
Side pick and roll, two-man game.
Devin Robinson, nope. And Edwards has it. Time figuring out the zone. Here's, oh no, he picked it up initially. Crump finally. Maton. That's in his wheelhouse. He already has 1-3 tonight.
Felt a little rushed though. Not that it was a bad shot, but it didn't feel like Yonte Maton had his rhythm. Felt like he rushed his jumper a little bit.
Pushed off on Chiosa. What is so hard to identify about Georgia's 2-3 zone?
Well, I don't know that it's hard to identify in this one because Mark Fox wants them to start it lower because it's Florida's guards aren't a threat from the outside. But when you start it lower, there's less room to operate in the paint. And so Florida having a hard time finding those openings. They were against the man-to-man.
Gators have hit just 5 of 16 from deep in this one. Maton hesitates. Here comes all the help in blue. Maton now falling away. Edwards rips it down, puts it back up. And a foul inside on Hayes.
Yeah, I love this. I love this from Georgia. The activity on the offensive glass. Yonte Maton takes a shot. This is what they need from players like Mike Edwards. This is what they need from Jawan Parker. Active on the glass. You don't get the bucket. Keep attacking, attacking, attacking. That's how you're going to scrap and claw your way back into this thing.
Parker, the junior from Booker T. Washington in Tulsa, Oklahoma, has another one coming. Egbunu returns. Maton will get a breather here. We assume we'll see him at the under 8 timeout. Ogbede back on the floor. This is a Georgia team that has yet to find a win against the top 25 this season. 0-4, including overtime losses at Florida and at Kentucky. Either one of those go a different way. You're talking about Georgia as a tournament team. stolen block by Albede. Frazier! And J.J. Frazier will be at the free throw line after the foul by Egbunu. 7:43 to go. This building's starting to light up here in the Classic City.
ESPN's exclusive presentation of college basketball is presented by CenturyLink, your link to what's next. And in part by Dave & Buster's, the only place to eat, drink, play, and watch sports.
Alongside Coach Seth Greenberg, I'm Adnan Virk in our college basketball studios. Bama's been leading South Carolina on the SEC Network, Coach, but here's Sindarius Thornwell.
Nice isolation play for Sindarius Thornwell. How do you get back in games? You get stops, and eventually you'll make a couple of shots.
The Gamecocks were 3 of 30 in the first half, and now it is just a three-point game with 36 seconds to go. Also of note, Maryland falls to Penn State, 70-64 the final there. First win against Maryland since 1990. Congrats to Penn State. Back over to Tom and Kara.
All right, Adnan, thanks. Yeah, here's why that South Carolina score is so important, to win here for Florida tonight. They'd be in a two-way tie for first, or a three-way tie in the loss column. Kentucky's playing LSU tonight, so we can almost chalk that one up. That'd be a three-way tie for first should South Carolina lose. And the logjam in the middle is what's amazing about this league. Nine teams within two games of each other from fourth place to 11th place. And when you get to Nashville and Bridgestone Arena for the SEC tournament, the difference there is either getting a double bye or having to play on the first day of the tournament.
Which playing on the first day of the tournament severely handicaps your ability to win the whole thing, because you're talking about five games in 5 days, right?
Yeah.
And that's tough.
Frazier's got 13. It's a five-point game. Whoa. Cold-blooded. Kayvon Allen, hurt or not, he drills a three, his first of the night. Edwards falling away. Remember, Yonte Mayton took a seat on the bench with more than 8 minutes to play. I thought maybe he would return at the under eight. Albede brings it down, and just as I was thinking that, there's big number one going to the scorer's table. Frazier tried to cross over. Don't do that in front of Casey Hill, kids. And Hill converts. The lead just like that is back to 10. It's like going from the yellow dress to the green one at halftime. Albede all alone. Barry with the big block. No basket on the jump ball. Possession arrow goes back to Florida. Seventh block of the night for Florida.
These Florida guards, great anticipation. All night long, we saw Chris Chioza in the first half, just taken away one-on-one, and there's Casey Hill off to the races.
11 steals tonight for Florida. So here they go, the side ball screen action again. They've been going under the screen. This time, Crump trying to fight over it. Turn Florida away. 6 minutes to go, 10-point game. Rebounded by Stone. Transition three. Oh. Casey Hill out front. It's his third. Thursday, big-time rivalry week doubleheader for you on ESPN at 8 o'clock. It's the 2017 version of the Battle for Tobacco Road. Number 8, North Carolina travels to Cameron to take on 18th-ranked Duke. Then out to Pauley Pavilion for 5th-ranked Oregon and number 10, UCLA. Both Sonic blockbusters will also stream live on the ESPN app and watch ESPN.
Can't wait for that. Coach K back. for the Duke Blue Devils. North Carolina with a more experienced team. Now, I think Duke's going to be okay. You know, I know they've had a lot of different lineups, pieces in and out, guys hurt. You have that much talent. You've got about 4 or 5 weeks left to get on the same page. I'll tell you what, I wouldn't want them in my bracket.
Isn't that what kind of what Jim Boeheim told us this weekend? Yeah, they'll be fine. Yeah. They'll be fine.
Yep.
Frazier's got 14. It's a 9-point game. Blocked by Alvede. Out to Frazier. Trying to beat Chiosa to the rack. And a foul on goal. It's ripped away by Florida. And Jackson took an elbow to the head when he was in there trying to get to the basketball. Egbunu had it. And we got one and one on the Florida end. But that's on maintenance's third. So John Egbunu to the free throw line.
What a missed opportunity for Georgia there. J.J. Frazier misses that layup. You go from it potentially being a 7-point game to now an 11-point game if Egbunu can make these free throws.
It's been a season of missed opportunities for this Georgia team. Big free throws from Egbunu. Let's check in with Adnan. What's going on down in South Carolina?
All right, Tom, thank you very much. A live looking right now with Seth Greenberg and Jay Williams because Alabama and South Carolina are tied at 57, 8.3 seconds left to go. Coach, how key is that man, Avery Johnson's experience in this situation?
It's huge. You see, he advanced the ball over half court like he would do if he was an NBA head coach, which he was. So he is very good in special situations, especially inside out of bounds. I would expect Avery Johnson Jr. to make a play.
Johnson for the win.
For the win, and no. Instead, we're going to have overtime. Alabama was leading much of this game. Jay Will, South Carolina storming back, and now we got free ball.
Here's something for players to recognize. Both teams are in the bonus, okay? Instead of settling for a jump shot, try to get somewhere to the rim, Seth. Put the refs once again in a position to make a call.
Instead,
Jay Will, rack it.
All day, rack it. Keep going, young fella. Change pace.
We'll keep you posted on OT. Tom, back to you and Kara.
All right, Adnan, thank you. First place on the line in the SEC. South Carolina alone in first, 9-1. Their lone loss came at Ruff, the only meeting this season between the Gamecocks and Wildcats. Meanwhile, Florida got Kentucky, and Kentucky lost on the road to Tennessee. The only bad loss among those three, if you want to look at it that way, was Florida losing to Vandy. Since then, they've had a team meeting. They challenged each other. They've won four in a row. They have an 11-point lead here with 4:37 to go. When we were gone, it was a Florida turnover by Egbunu and a foul by Egbunu. Tom Hart with Carol Austin. It's an 11-point lead for number 17 Florida. Where can Georgia find the offense here down the stretch?
Well, the offense for Georgia all season long has gone through two players. That's Yante Maton, number one, all the way on your left, and J.J. Frazier, the diminutive guard for Georgia. He's a high-powered scoring attack, and Yante Maton has had a pretty good night for the Bulldogs. 17 points, but he has been under attack from the Florida front line. One defender, two defenders, three defenders. They have not made it easy for him. He's earned every single field goal that he's made, six of them in total. And, you know, sense a little fatigue from Yante Maton. He's had to work so hard just to catch the basketball, just to get quality looks at the basket.
He's turned it over five times tonight. In the last matchup with Florida, when he fouled out of, he turned it over six times. They found a way to harass him. 11-point deficit for J.J. Frazier and the Dogs. Good ball movement. Had a good shot.
Hill. And Florida in a bit of a slump now. Not as big as Georgia's. Georgia's missed its last 10. Now 11. Not a good time to go cold. Barry on the baseline. Grabs a foul from Etorian Woolridge. And when we return, Canyon Barry will be at the free throw line. Under 4 to go in Athens. Kara taught me how to say rivalry week.
Yes.
It's a doubleheader this Thursday. 2017 version of the Battle for Tobacco Road. Number 8, North Carolina. 18th ranked Duke. That's followed up with another big one out west. 5th ranked Oregon and number 10 UCLA. Sonic Blockbuster is also streaming live on the ESPN app and watch ESPN. Well, it's been as even as you could imagine. 48 wins apiece over the last 96, dating to February 26th of 1977. 7,437 points apiece over the last 96 meetings. Mike Krzyzewski back on the sidelines for Duke. He'll meet Roy Williams in a ranked matchup for the 25th time. That is amazing. Canyon Barry has 8 tonight. Florida's lead is a dozen. He has made 35 consecutive free throws now. Meanwhile, Georgia has made just 4 of its last 26 field goal attempts. Mayton all alone. There's the jam. He hasn't been alone much tonight.
It starts on the defensive end if you're Georgia. Getting stops, the most important thing right now. Nice cut by Hill. Yep.
Frazier charged with his second. Casey Hill at the free throw line, 63% from the line on the season.
And it looks like J.J. Frazier just lost Casey Hill along that baseline. They don't have awareness on the weak side. And if you're Georgia, I mean, that's really important because you're down double digits. You need to get stops. Everyone's got to take care of their player.
Ten of Hill's 12 have come in the second half. Georgia has been held to 31% shooting tonight by one of the best defenses in the SEC. They've been turned over 16 times, and that's led to 18 for the Gators. Shot clock is at 7. Gators content to milk this thing. Chioza. Wow! Anytime Kara Lawson giggles, it was a good play. Mayton, that's another block if you want to count it for Florida. Parker is able to knock it down. I mean, what is it about Chris Chioza? Is it everything?
No, it's just from our vantage point, he's driving in, and I'm thinking, this is not going to end well for him. And then he finds a way to get it up on the glass and finish it. That degree of difficulty, that's why I was chuckling.
We saw a great point guard this weekend, London Parentes, yes, from Virginia. Like Chioza, an upperclassman. And like Chioza, two guys who just have this extra sense and a killer sense for the junior from Memphis. And then Chioza with the bump.
I mean, Florida has just put the basketball in Chris Chioza and Casey Hill's hands here in the second half, and they have delivered.
I think one of the words we used to describe Parentes this weekend was nuance.
Yeah. There's definitely some nuance to Chris Chioza's game as well. He has great command. and a great understanding of what is happening around him, not just his man, but where his teammates are, and does a great job of being creative to find ways to get them good looks.
South Carolina and Alabama in overtime over Colonial Life Arena in Columbia. An Alabama win, and if Florida holds on, means we'll have a three-way tie for first. Parker. Nope. Brought down by Chioza, having a great all-around game. He turned into third triple-double in school history 2 games ago against Mizzou. 12 points, 12 boards, and 10 assists. He was the first player in college basketball in 9 years to have a triple-double in a game in which he did not start. Shot clock at 8. What will he do now? Oh, my gosh. Beautiful feed, and Barry finishes it. Points from Florida's bench this half. Frazier with the circus shot. Frazier and Mayton have combined for 36 of George's 57. You feel for a guy like J.J. Frazier, senior from Glenville, Georgia, all over the record books among leaders in Georgia history. But some gut punch losses over the course of this season to ranked teams, including overtime losses at Florida and at Kentucky. What could be the difference between Georgia going to the NCAA tournament or playing in the NIT? Meanwhile, on the other side, as Frazier comes out with under a minute to go, this, I think, is a good example as any for Florida over this 5-game win streak of what makes them so good.
And this was a solid road win, devoid of an outstanding performance on the offensive end from Kayvon Allen. Devin Robinson didn't have one of his better evenings. But Chioza and Casey Hill, those two players together, they can both initiate the offense. They're a little bit different stylistically as point guards. And I loved how the front line was really a group effort against Yonte Mayton to make things more difficult. Hayes came in and did a great job. Leon, I mean, this was just a team effort. This is a Florida team that's trending in the right direction.
And in the end, this will be a road win against a team with an RPI of 54. Mike White's squad has won 5 in a row, most of them in dominating fashion. 72-60 our final here. With Florida being first place tomorrow, we will find out shortly. Back to the studio to get you caught up on all the latest. Good night from Athens.